大家好，我是艾尔查晚年。2019年的1月25号，美国佛罗里达州塞维纳郡的警局接到了一个报警电话。
Great, and who are we checking on?
His name is Cody Amato. His last name is A-M-A-T-O.
Okay, and what was the reason for the well-being check?
He said the time that we worked together, he didn't show up for work today, and nobody can get a hold of him. His phone's going straight to voicemail, and he's not like that at all. He would never just not show up or not answer or not call. So.No one's heard from him since about 10 p.m. last night, so we're all kind of worried.
All right, and I know you said that it's not like him to do this. Is there any other reason for concerns, like health conditions or anything like that?
Not from him. Like, I know his brother was at home, and I know his brother has been sick. His brother does suffer from depression, and...
Cody Amato 是奥兰多这个 Orlando Regional Medical Center 的一名麻醉护士。麻醉护士啊，是一个基本上是要随叫随到的一个工作，所以手机呢基本上都是24小时开着的，任何时候都有可能会一个电话就被叫去上班了。在此前的5年的时间里面呢 ，Cody 的这个工作经历呢是非常非常完美的，从来没有缺席过工作。但是这一次呢，从前一天晚上的10点开始，就没人再能够联系上他，于是同时打电话报警，要求警察进行一个叫 well-being check， 一般就翻译成叫做安危检查，也可以叫做 welfare check 或者叫做 wellness check。 就是当你担心你的朋友啊，或者说你的家人的这个情况的时候，你可以要求警察去上门去检查他的情况，你呢甚至还可以申请陪同。最常见的安危检查的理由就是什么无响应啊，电话不接啊，短信不回啊，家里敲门没人开啊，这也就是这通报警电话同事说的这个原因。如果只有这一个原因的话，有些时候你可能需要等警察等很长很长的时间，甚至他们有可能就根本就不来。所以在这个基础之上呢，最好还是告诉警察还有别的理由，比如说常见的什么精神有问题啊，健康有隐患啊，年纪特别大啊，或者什么无故缺席啊，包括什么没有去上班啊，啊约好了看医生没去啊等等。这个打电话的这个人是 Cody 在医院工作的一个同事，他看来对于这个安危检查呢是非常熟悉的啊，非常的专业，一上来就给出了无响应啊、无故缺席和他这个兄弟有精神问题三个原因，这使得警察肯定就会优先处理他的报警。很快呢，警察就到达了科迪的家。
Sheriff's Office。
进门之后的影像呢不适合公开。总之，警察在家里一进门的这个储藏室里面发现了 Cody 的尸体，他头部中枪，侧面倒地，身体呢是蜷缩在一起的，就像我们平时睡觉的那个姿势啊。身上呢还是穿着医院的工作的衣服，可见的是一回家就遇袭，连换衣服都没能来得及。此外呢，还在家里的厨房发现了 Cody 的父亲 Chad Amato 的尸体，他呢是仰面躺在厨房的地上，头上有着2处明显的枪伤，现场呢是有明显的逃离的痕迹的，就很像是头部中了一枪之后试图逃跑，很快又中了一枪，从而倒地身亡。更可怕的是 ，Cody 的母亲也被枪杀了，他呢是在书房里面坐在自己的这个椅子上，身体趴在电脑桌上，很明显呢是在办公的这个时候从后面被人从近距离一枪击中头部。这个 Amato 的一家一共有5口人啊，除了家里过世的这3口呢，还有2个儿子。老大 Jason 呢，当年是35岁，很早呢就搬出去自己生活了，已经很久不跟父母一起了。而常年还住在这个地方的，除了3个受害者以外，还有一个家里的小儿子 Grant Amato， 格兰特。本来应该在家的格兰特，现在是活不见人死不见尸，他的嫌疑呢就非常的大。很快第二天警察得到线报，说是他的车呢就停在离家不远的一个宾馆的门口，随后警察出警以极高的重视程度逮捕了格兰特。
You're being cooperative, sir. We appreciate that. Some Seminole County detectives want to talk to you, so we're going to get the handcuffs off of you. You know, it's just a normal routine when we encounter someone that we want to make sure you're safe. Now we know you don't have any weapons, we'll get those restraints off of you.
视频我是剪辑过的，现场实际上有超过十名的警察，荷枪实弹着，穿着防弹衣，拿着防爆盾牌，进行了战术走位来逮捕格兰特的。这个规格呢是相当的高。我不知道大家对于这种警察在逮捕现场的这种战略布局啊、战术走位啊、包括他们的装备啊是否感兴趣？以后呢，我们可以专门做一个视频来讲解。格兰特随后就被带到警局进行审讯。
Did you get a watch? Did you coke or anything?
No. I'll hold off on this.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Eva.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm here.
Hey, we really appreciate you coming up here with us. And you know, any time during this you need to stop and go to the bathroom, want a drink,
snack,
thing, just let me know and we'll be happy to get you in. My name is Danny Anderson, and I'm a deputy Kimmel County Sheriff's Office, as is Eva. So we just want to talk to you a little bit, and we'll get this in and out, be on our way. Okay.
有段时间没有从技术角度去做过审讯的视频了，估计最近也来了一批新的粉丝嘛。那么这一次呢，咱们从头说一说，警察在审讯中呢，跟传统我们在电影中间看到的那种对立的关系是很不一样的。实际上都是会采取这种很战略性的这种拉近距离的这种策略。警察表现的这种就像朋友间聊天一样的这种口吻啊，也包括去询问对方啊有没有什么需求啊，要不要罐可乐啊。他们也会说这种啊，我们真的很感谢您来这里配合我们的工作啊，这一类的话，大家可以理解成啊，在警察中呢，他们是预设所有的嫌疑人呢都先是目击者，然后才是嫌疑人。那么同时他们也会说啊，任何时候你要上厕所啊，要喝点什么，要吃点什么啊，你就跟我说啊。这个东西在英文中间叫 building rapport 啊，是搞好关系的这样一个大的一个策略。那最后警察说的这句话就是，我们就是跟你聊聊啊，很快然后咱们就都可以走了。这很明显呢是警察一个降低整个事件严重程度的一个战术。这个战术在审讯心理学上叫做 minimization， 是最小化战术。其实跟搞好关系是同一个路子上的东西，都是为了让对方去放松啊，让对方去降低防备啊。但是这个警局的这个桌子吧，选的实在是太大了。我是没有见过警局就是这么小的一个审讯室里面有这么大的一个桌子的，这个桌子就导致嫌犯和警察其实就是完全是坐在桌子的两面是对面了，这个本身就足够糟糕了，会制造出来一种双方在桌子两面去对立的一种状况。同时嫌犯从心理上呢也可以使用这个桌子呢作为一个屏障啊，或者说像盾牌一样的这个感觉。就大家可以想嘛，如果没有这个桌子在这里的话，那么嫌犯会感觉非常的暴露。此外呢，这个桌子你看摆在这个位置呢，完全挡住了嫌犯这个下半身所有的这个动作，也会使得警察就缺失很多重要的身体语言上的信息。还有就是当你有这么大的一个桌子摆在双方中间的时候，警察是完全没有办法向嫌犯去靠近，去给对方心理上去施压的。然后我还注意到了嫌犯的椅子啊也是带轮子的，跟警察其他这个椅子是一样的，这个也不好。嫌犯等于说是可以随便去自由的去移动的，这个增加了嫌犯的控制感，也减少了警察可操作的余地。因为想如果说是警察想要靠近嫌犯的话，嫌犯是可以向后退的。这个细微的差别在审讯室的心理大战上对于警察是很不利的。一般来说都是给他们一个就是看上去是一样的椅子，但是警察坐这个椅子呢是有轮子的，而嫌犯坐那个是没有轮子的。
I've been applying for jobs for the last couple weeks. I've gotten like 3 or 4 callbacks. And then I went on a job interview yesterday for a home infusion nurse job.
How'd that go?
I mean, it was all good. They didn't have anything. They said that they'd probably be getting back to me by Tuesday or Thursday this coming week.
Get you back to work?
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, it's like it's a crappy world when, you know, you don't have any money.
Sure.
You can't, you know, do anything, so.
Financially, how's the nursing what you did? I'm sorry, I just don't know that much. She knows all.
格兰特跟他的哥哥一样是名护士吧，但是与哥哥很不一样的是他的学习很差，并没有能够从大学毕业。他算是非常幸运的，还是找到了一份就是普通的一个基础的护士的工作，但是他却没有抓住这个机会去奋发图强，反而因为在医院里面偷药被抓获了，而且偷的是异丙酚这种极为强力的麻醉剂。此后呢，因为这个事情啊，他不仅是被医院开除了，而且还被起诉了。但是我现在要告诉大家的是啊，他确实没有撒谎，他确实昨天早上去了这家公司面试，但是在前天的晚上，也就是1月24号，就是他在家里枪杀了他的父母和他的哥哥。第二天早上，他跟没事人一样正常的去参加了这个工作的面试，而且根据面试官的这个证言啊，他当天表现得很正常，甚至表现得还不错，这个医院还打算雇佣他。
Financially, how's the nursing what you did? I'm sorry, I just don't know that much. She knows a lot more about nursing. The nursing, how does it pay?
I mean, if you work your standard 3 to 12 hours a week, you get anywhere between, I'd say, $45,000 and $55,000 a year. So, I mean, it's not bad. I think my best year I made like 55,000.
55.
Because I rarely worked overtime.
Right.
You know, and I was just, because I had the whole plan of going to graduate school. Mm-hmm. So I was just kind of using it as a stepping stone
right.
for that time.
Just to pay the bills. To
right.
get you where you gotta, gotcha. Girlfriends.
Girlfriends. I had, like my high school sweetheart, girlfriend for about 5 years. And then ever since then, no, like, official girlfriends, no flings or anything like that.
Dates here and there?
Dates occasionally, but, mm-hmm. I mean, not really. Kind of focused on, like, just getting through the life goals that, you know, I wanted to achieve.
What do you like to do?
What do I like to do? I like to watch anime. Me and my brother kind of started doing that back 5 years ago, I'd say. He kind of got me into it.
What is it? I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know what it is.
I mean,
I thought you said MMA. I'm like, okay. And then when you start explaining to it. In fact, how long have you been out of work?
I've been out of work for 6 months, since June.
How did you pay? That's a lot of money for to be out of work.
My brother.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. My brother.
What does he do?
He's a CRNA.
Anything left in savings?
Nothing left in savings. I think I had like $300-$400. But
brother kind of helping you through?
Yeah. I mean, brother was helping me. My dad was covering the rent that he calls it, which is just like the monthly payment that for us to help since we all live at home.
What was that? What did you figure that out?
$600
each?
A month. Yeah. And then...
it's not a bad deal, is it?
No. And then, I mean, he was covering like cell phone. We were paying for our own internet.
这警察开始问像什么收入啊、女友这种都是属于非常私密的信息了。当然警察问他很正常，但是作为配合来调查的格兰特呢，他配合的就明显过头了。我要是被警察抓了，你问可以，但你是不是告诉我我为什么被抓了，是什么案子，是出什么事儿了？我人都坐在审讯室里面被你们审了半天了，这可不是闲聊的地方啊。审讯到现在41分钟了，完整的审讯我是看了的。到目前为止，警察和格兰特都完全没有提到过为什么要来这里审讯。
And I mean, during like this whole time, I mean, kind of like with just a few examples I've given you, he'd take care of everything for
me. Always there for you.
Yeah.
Always there to support you.
Always there.
Fight with you 1 minute, but make sure that you were not stuck in jail for some silly charge.
Right.
The next.
And, yeah, I mean, he was just, he's always been there for me, so.
在他哥哥的这个话题上，格兰特也明显的过头了。他这不是回答问题了，而是在植入信息了。尤其你看他刚才那个 and 这很典型，他是绞尽脑汁的再去想他哥哥对他好的一些什么啊，这么好那么好一些案例。不过这个哥哥柯迪呢，事实上确实是对他很好的。他又不赚钱，很多时候花的钱不是他父母的钱，就是他哥的钱。
With my oldest brother Jason, not so much, just because. And then he was heavily restricted when we were younger, for lying and stuff like that to our dad. So basically, he would like.He would go to school and then he'd come home. He'd have to stay in his room. There's like no TV or anything like that, especially enough, you know, 15 years ago or something like that. But, you know, he'd come down for dinner and then he'd go back up and he'd do his work. On the weekends and whatnot, he would like go out and pick weeds and like do that stuff and then come in and then do the same thing.
Cody's definitely when you're way closer with.
Yeah. Hands down. He would like have his moments where he would get extremely upset. Like, you know, he never gets violent, I guess you could say. But, like, at one point, he got so upset that he, like, pushed a cabinet and then it, like, dented into the wall. And he, I mean, so he'll, like, lose his temper, kind of like my dad. But, yeah, I mean, at least with me, he's always been, like, where he's there for me. Like, whatever it takes, regardless of what's happening, I'm going to take care of it for you.
从 forensic linguistics 就是犯罪语言学的角度来说，这一段是很值得仔细的去看看的。犯罪语言学中间有一个很重要的方法，叫做 SCAN 法，也就是 statement analysis， 就翻译成叫做语言分析法吧。这个方法就比较注重语言的结构和具体的内容。警察这里呢，实际上只是很简单的提了一下他哥，而格兰特提供的口供呢是没必要的，过于细节了。他描述他哥啊，有些时候会不开心，然后毫不犹豫的啊，举了一个推柜子的一个例子。这个推柜子的这个例子就是一个特别有画面感的描述啊，在专业上叫做 vivid description 啊，是 scan 会很注意的这种点。同时逻辑上来说，他刚刚那句话，你看他前一句说他永远都不会暴力，然后紧接着下面就说什么暴力推柜子啊，这前后是冲突的，不是说这么说话就有问题，而是这是欺诈性语言常见的一种叙述方式。还有就是他拉开距离的语言太多了，这个在犯罪语言学上叫做 hedging 啊，就是隔开啊，让你看。 不清。就像他说啊，你可以这么说啊，有点像啊 ，I guess you can say 啊 ，it's kind of like， 这种都会让我怀疑他是否是在刻意的操纵，去塑造一个刻意的一个故事。然后我们从另外一个角度去看大的，就是 CDA 叫做 Critical Discourse Analysis， 就是批判性话语分析的这个角度。这个方法说白了就比较注重看他说这个话他背后的动机和目的是什么。就你看他最后说哥哥啊总是对自己很好，任何时候都会为自己出头啊，会搞定一切啊。你联合他前面说的，他就是想刻意的去塑造出来一个愤怒但是无条件支持自己的一个哥哥的一个形象。
But then, I mean, I know for me, I had been bummed out just because, like, I've been out of work. I've, you know, my whole life it's been school, work, school, back to work, and then just, I mean, that's it. You know, sacrificed all my 20s and everyone tailgating or anything like that.
你看啊，咱们现在看右上角，审讯已经进行了这48分钟、49分钟了。你看警察就是不停的在问格兰特各种各样的问题，而格兰特就是坐在这里啊，侃侃而谈的回答，一次都没有质疑我为什么被逮捕了，你们警察到底是想干什么，发生什么事了。我以前在做审讯无辜嫌疑人那个系列里面的时候，我曾经说过，无辜的人呢总是有很多的问题，而有罪的人呢总是有很多的答案。很明显无辜的人并不了解整个事情是什么，那么现在被警察怀疑，现在在这个审讯室里面被审，他们会有一肚子的问题想要问。而有罪的人呢非常清楚整个事情是什么。这里这个格兰特就是个典型，警察不提他也不提，他就坐在这里面回答警察的问题，他自己一个问题也没有。这就是他跟无辜的人一个很大的区别。还有从审讯心理学的角度来讲，每一个人走进审讯室的时候都是紧张和焦虑的，不管你是无辜还是不无辜。但是我们前面已经提到了，深受李德法和现代审讯心理学训练的这个警察呢，会采取搞好关系的这个方法来问话，对吧？在这种策略之下，随着审讯持续进行下去，对方也会相对来说会越来越放松。就可能他一开始回答问题会很紧啊，他回答的他会很短啊，可能结结巴巴呀，身体也是这种内收的，然后这种阻挡型的动作。但是呢，后来呢，他会逐步的越来越放松，身体会逐渐的打开。当然，如果持续进行下去，时间太长了之后，他可能会又重新的紧张起来。所以他们的状态呢，是一个上上下下的一条曲线。而有罪的人不一样，因为他们会特别害怕被警察审出来点什么。所以他们会进行 impression management， 或者从身体语言的这个角度来讲叫做 deception management， 也就是他们的表现呢会相对来说会比较平，就是自身的波动区别不大，就像一个在牌桌上在赌钱的一个赌徒一样。通货膨胀暴升的时代，暴涨的房贷利率和保险成本，不稳定的金融市场，让很多投资者都感受到了不安和压力。一份稳健的投资正是大家在这个经济下行的时代所追求的。 12.8 的固定年回报率的大牛基金给广大消费者吃了个定心丸。澳大利亚大家知道是这个世界上畜牧业高度发达的国家之一，牛畜存栏量高达2880万头，而且还是世界前三大的牛肉出口国之一，在国际上享有高品质的盛名，广受消费者青睐。最新数据统计显示，澳大利亚大牛产业每年营业额高达700亿澳元，同体牛肉产量高达187万吨。大牛基金充分利用天然的优势，结合澳大利亚的牛业稳定持续发展的这个条件，为全球投资者提供独特的投资机会。在众多的项目中还是独树一帜的，作为澳大利亚少有的多元化的农业投资项目，其中包括了各类的养牛项目啊、养牛地产资产啊、屠宰场资产啊、数字农业系统等，项目内容是覆盖全澳各州的。大牛基金的牛业专业管理团队深耕澳洲市场，拥有丰富的育牛经验，切实提供多重安全保证，将风险降到最低。其基金管理团队拥有托管机制以及客户的资金保障机制，公开透明的运营系统和严格的流程管理。目前这个大牛基金因为它 12.8 的超高固定回报率啊，已经收到了全球各地投资者的关注和认可，同时也期待更多投资者的加入。
He would like allow me to spend money that he had, like with his credit card or something like that. But it's like then whenever I did, it was like a huge problem.
Okay, so you had one of his credit cards.
Yeah.
And what were you buying with it?
Well, what I was doing is over the past 4 months or something like that, I've been talking to this woman online.
Who's she?
She's...As embarrassing as it is, she's a cam model.
A what?
A cam model. Do either of you guys know that?
Nope. Just like all the videos, you have to tell us.
A cam model, it's like it's like a virtual girlfriend, I guess you could say.
Okay.
Like that type of situation.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the money went to her.
Okay, where's she at?
She lives in Bulgaria.
Where?
Bulgaria.
Where's that?
over in Europe. It's like outside of Germany.
Okay.
Something like that.
You ever been there?
No.
Okay.
It wasn't that serious.
So what would you give her money for?
Just for like the time online with her.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was just like that type of thing.
And what did she charge? By the minute? By the hour?
Minute.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how much is it per minute?
Oh God, I think it was like 90 tokens a minute, and it's like the conversion rate for all of that is like $600 for like 5,000 or something tokens or something like that. So, and then it was 4 hours a night. So that's basically just where all the, like the costs went to was you pay real money for the tokens, then you use the company's digital currency for that.
So you do that. And when did you meet her?
I met her at the beginning of July. Yeah, at the very beginning of July.
Okay, and still talking to her?
Still, yeah. I mean, more just on like Twitter,
okay.
Like just through direct messaging.
How much do you think you spent on this? Because it seems kind of pricey.
Yeah.
90 tokens and $5,000 for how many tokens?
No, it's $600 for 5,000.
For 5,000,
yeah.
Okay. So how much do you think you spent on this?
Probably close to like $200,000, I'd say.
$200,000?
Yeah.
And where'd the money come from?
Money came from me, my brother, and then my dad.
Did they know where the money was going to?
They didn't know that it was going to a cam model. I was saying that it was going towards my Twitch streaming, like advertising, like putting my name out there and that type of thing.
Twitch 是一个国外的一个游戏直播的一个平台，有点类似于国内的什么斗鱼啊、虎牙啊这一类的。那么格兰特是很喜欢在家打游戏的，于是他失业之后就告诉父母，他打算职业的去打游戏、去直播、去赚钱。他的父母呢，实际上也是很支持他的，但是并不知道他是把这个钱啊，把这么多钱啊，都花在一个网红身上了。六个月花了$200,000啊，这只是网上在地球另一端的一个保加利亚的一个主播而已。我经常看到抖音上面那些主播了，老在直播，我都想这玩意儿能挣钱吗？那看来这真能啊！哎，六个月$200,000啊，140万人民币啊，基本上每一个晚上都要花美金要花2500块，人民币要花20000块钱啊。嗯。
He had apparently found out that I was speaking to her again, and when I came back on the 4th, my mom picked me up from the Cornerstone place.And then me and my mom met my dad at California Pizza Grill or Kitchen in Waterford Lakes. Mm-hmm. And he had this list front and back on a piece of paper of all the rules. This is what's going to happen. This is why I'm acting the way that I'm going to act. I'm not going to be dad anymore. I'm going to be Chad. And I basically told him that I'm going to be present. I'm going to do what I can. I'm going to start trying to get jobs now. I told him what my plan was. You know, it wasn't really my intention to continue talking to this woman, but it just kind of happened. Mm-hmm. And then because there was like that emotional connection, I guess you could say, between her and me, like I like, you know, it felt like a relationship, you know, I didn't want to just stop cold turkey on it. So he had apparently found out and then
happy.
Right. And one of the stipulations was that he told me at the dinner was if you speak to this woman again, you're out of the house. Like, I'm kicking you out. You can pack up your shit, and then you're off my property. Mm-hmm. And then because of the way that he used to be, he had told me that basically if that happens, that if I ever step back onto his property, that he would kill me. So, you know, on Thursday, that all happened, and then I was in the process. I was getting all my stuff together. I was piecemealing it out to the car. And then, you know, I had an interview on Friday. So I had to get my suit out to my car. I was trying to just get all of my necessities as best as I could from, you know, a lifetime of living inside the house. And then my brother was working that night. And I think he was working like one of his long nights, but he ended up getting off early. And then I had met with my brother before he came home, just like in the neighborhood area. Mm-hmm. And then
where at?
It was just on the like the back side of the house, like along, I don't remember what that road's called, but it's like you take the bend where it has those two blinking lights,
mm-hmm.
and then it's just down that road a ways. And then I basically brought him up to speed, and he had told me that he was going to do whatever.
What time was that, you think?
God, what time was it? So then, yeah, I spoke with Cody. He told me about all that. He had given me his debit so that, because, I mean, I don't have any money, and I don't know where to go. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd never been out of the house on my own. And then the last thing that I was told was just that, you know, basically, once again, that he'll take care of it because...
This is Cody.
This is Cody.
What time is this, approximately?
首先 Grant 有一个很坏的一个习惯，我相信他自己应该是不知道的，但是坐在对面的这两个警察大概率是能看得出来的，因为这是比较典型的一个在审讯室里面撒谎常出现的一个身体语言，就是他这老是这个手立起来啊，像在桌子上就切什么东西一样啊，这是一个极强的一个控制性的一个动作，他手心是向内的，手背是向外的，这是在制造一个屏障，就像一个盾牌一样啊，两个手呢它是相对而言它是合在一起的，而不是它是分开的啊，是要胸前门户大开的这种，这呢就是一个自我保护的一个身体语言，而他的眼神呢，他不会去看向对方，而是向下看，去看自己的手，然后看自己的手在那怎么去动，并且呢他说话声调也是有改变，这样做的时候声调总是向下走，大家可以注意观察他，看他后面是不是一样的，但目前我发现他这道动作已经出现过好几次了，而且每一次都是出现在我对他有所怀疑的时候，我相信不是巧合。
I'd say a little after 10:30ish at night.
Thursday night.
Okay. I was basically just waiting in that parking lot until I had to leave to go to the interview. And then, I mean, that was the last, because again, it's like,No cell phone service. I mean, email was literally like my only form of communication. And then, you know, yeah, I just, I went to the DoubleTree because I was like, I can't just stay in my car again all night.
Right.
And then I was just there the whole night.
Talk to Cody, talk to mom, talk to
dad. No, I couldn't talk to anybody because I didn't have.
But you had the phone in the room.
Oh, yeah, I did have the phone in the room. But, yeah.
Call anybody from the phone room?
No, I didn't even honestly think about it because I was like, you know, away from a place where I had lived for 25 years or something like that.
Sure.
I had never, you know, as embarrassing as it is, I'd never been on my own. Because he had, I don't know how he found out, but he had apparently found out and then.
Found out what?
That I was talking to.
You were still talking
to the woman, yeah.And then he came in, and then he asked me in a calmer state, I guess you could say, like, basically the leading question of, you know, why do you think we're about to have this conversation? Giving me, I guess, that opportunity to be honest and truthful, to maybe tone it down a little bit. I, of course, did what I always did, where I kind of didn't admit to it.
Uh-huh.
And then he came out and he told me that I had been doing that.
He had proof.
Yeah.
Have an argument?
Yeah. And then, you know, he got just, he had kind of reverted back to the way that he was when we were younger, where, you know, he kind of, you know, pulled me up from the couch and then he was yelling at me to pack my shit up and just get out of the house, that he was the one who had to be the hammer and that, you know, why am I making him have to go through this?And all this other kind of stuff.
Okay.
So, you know, basically I had...
So he's becoming violent.
I mean,
like the way you described
right,
it when you, were,
right.
When you and Cody were kids.
Right.
What did he do?
Like I said, he pulled me up from the couch just by, like, the shirt that I was wearing.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, after that, he was basically just having that yelling where it was kind of like cracking. You know, like his voice would either crack or he would just... He was basically just yelling at that point. And,
You have your argument and you pack your stuff?
I have my argument and then I'm packing my stuff. I'm, you know, taking it out to the car. It took me like a couple hours to get as much as I could, just kind of out into there.
在这一段里面，他出现了更多更明显的 hedging， 就他的这一套词啊，什么然后啊，所以啊，然后啊，你知道的 ，you know， 然后 then， 你知道的，所以出现的太多太频繁了，这都是很典型的，在他提前编好了一个故事之后，再重新的讲述出来会出现的语言。还有就是一如既往的，在一些并不重要的点上面说的过于细节了，像什么我一点点把东西都去拿到车上啊，我要面试，所以我要去拿一个西装啊，这个点上描述的细致程度以及 他方面相比就脱节了，过于夸张了。因为有些东西就说的特别的模糊，像是你吵架是怎么吵的，你们都说了些什么。当然这一定程度上跟警察是怎么问他的问题是有关系的。但是你想想吧，如果你跟你朋友去诉说你跟你男朋友你跟你女朋友去吵架这个事情的话，你会对于吵架的内容叙述的极其概括，但是会特别强调自己搬家都这个过程我都拿了些什么吗？还有更重要的事情，就房间的这个椅子一直摆在那边，看得我就很难受，这个椅子就不应该在这里啊，这是寝室浴室的一个忌讳。我们看审讯室的设计，一般来说都是这样一个没有窗户又没什么装修，很简简单单啊，很小的一个房间，这就是为了给嫌犯一种他们被孤立的感觉，让他们感觉他们被困住了，去增加他们的压力。同时为了去增加这种因为空间带来的这种孤立感，警察还会刻意的将这些桌椅摆放在一些战略性的一些位置，让嫌犯去坐到一个角落去，让他们可以看到身后的门，但是他们过不去，因为警察在这儿嘛，他警察是坐在嫌犯和门之间的，就给他们一种你必须得解决掉我，解决掉面前的这个警察才能够离开的感觉。但是因为这个空椅子的存在，由空间带来的孤立和这个压力其实是小了一些的。你想当你没有这个椅子在这里的时候，嫌疑人对于空间的概念其实远比你有这个椅子在这里的时候是要模糊的。就换句话说，有一个椅子在这里的时候，椅子虽然占地方了，但从心理上来说房间其实显得是更大了。我不知道大家有没有那种经历啊，就像我当年我求学的那个时候，我就住过很小的单间啊，就你只住一个房间，房间里就放了很多家具啊，放了很多东西，等你哪天搬家的时候，你看着这个空荡荡的这个房间，你会突然间的意识到，哦，这个房间竟然这么小啊！然后你再看见外面那一堆东西，那一堆家具的时候，你就在想，哇，这当年是怎么的装得下这么多东西的？这个现象啊，可以解释的角度有很多。那么我这里主要是想说，人的这个所谓叫做 cognitive mapping， 叫认知绘图的这个问题。当我们走进一个空间的时候，实际上我们大脑会扫描这个空间，并且标记每个物体，编辑给每个物体一个标记，一个记号，编辑一个记号。当你有这么一个椅子在这里的时候，这个空间呢，就那个方向呢，就会变得有用，也就会变得熟悉，房间就会比没有这个椅子在那的时候就会变得至少能是更能存放东西，也就是所谓的变得更大了。我前面提到了有用这个概念很重要，因为这个牵扯到了 functional reference point， 就是说是有用的标记的记号的问题。因为假设摆在这里的这个东西对你来说是个没用的，或者说是一个不熟悉的一个东西，然后这个东西对于每个人来说是不一样的。比如说对我来说，如果这个椅子的这个地方摆的是一个煤气罐的话，那煤气罐这个动作来说，它对我既没有用也不熟悉，那么即使它跟这个椅子一样大，我也会觉得房间瞬间啊小了好多。但是比如说你摆一个衣架吧，啊，那对我来说它有用了，它熟悉了，那对我来说房间其实是变大了的。还有就是当有这样的一个空椅子摆在这里的时候，首先因为椅子存在本来就是一个干扰，嫌疑人可以浮想联翩，哎，是不是一会儿还有人要坐在这边，哎，他就可能会提醒他，哎，我是不是可以去请律师。而律师对于警察来说是大忌，是警察在审讯中间最重要要避免的事情，没有之一，没有比避免律师更重要的事情了。同时这个椅子呢，也会给他们一种就是现在我们不管在说什么谈什么都不是最终结果，也失去了就是失去了时间上的紧迫感。总之这个椅子真的就不应该在这儿。并且我们能看出来这个女警坐的这个椅子呢跟其他的三个椅子是不一样的。这女警坐这个椅子应该是她自己推进来的。她应该把她的那个椅子弄出去，然后把角落的那个椅子拉过来她再坐。还有一个就是这个女警在审讯中间一直在记笔记，看得我都刺挠。不是说审讯室里面不能记笔记。实际上 FBI 也是推荐两个警察在审讯室里面一起去审嫌犯的，并且说了副手的这个人呢是可以记笔记的，但是一般来说都是偶尔的在关键问题上记一下。审讯室呢也有一些战术是跟记笔记有关的，像他这是真的在记录信息，审的现在哗哗写了好几页纸了，一般是不这么干的，也没有那个必要。你像这么重大的案件，审讯室里面现在坐着这两个警察，隔壁的房间里还坐着其他的警察在同步的看着监控，在看着这一切呢，要记也是那些人记。咱们接着看吧。
And then, yeah, it's like mom's kind of just staying out of it to a certain degree because she knows like how dad can be. And then, yeah, I mean, you know, I was.And that's just pretty much where I was just kind of like waiting.
So you wait outside. Did anybody call Cody and tell him what's going on?
No, not that I know of.
Okay.
这个 no 说的太过于坚决了。他前面还在收拾东西嘛，对吧？后面就出去在大街上去 等着了，父母有没有给他哥打电话他应该是不知道的，至少他应该是不确定。你看他前面说那些事情的时候用了那么多拉开距离的语言，这种本来不应该是很了解，本来不是应该很确定的事情，反倒特别的坚决。
How did you know to meet Cody down the street?
It's because、my mom had actually come and told me that, you know, she, again, she was trying to bridge the gap, and then before I actually physically leftI had told my mom that, you know, I'm going to be close. I'm going to be local. I'm just going to be like down the street.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
so you left.
So I left.
Okay. What else happened?
What else happened? Mm-hmm. Then after I had met with Cody, then that's where, you know, I was again just kind of staying around that area. And then I just went to the Publix. And then to my knowledge, I mean, that was like, that was the last interaction that I had with my...the three members of my family was that.
Was about what time? Last time you saw your mom was what time?
哇，我就感觉我在看一个写的很烂的一个小说一样，就这个故事编的简直就是炸裂，所有的人物都是 NPC， 有任务的时候才出现，没任务的时候都不知道在干什么。你看完全的主人公视角，每一个人干了什么，动机清清楚楚，目标清晰，结果简单明确。你是格林童话，写童话才这么写。但是比如说你跟你爹吵架，你妈一句台词都没有吗？你花了好几个小时搬家，中间没有任何 NPC 出来互动，你出门了，你开了个车，你等在路边，没有一个人跟你联系过，没有人知道你在哪里，你哥就知道你在哪里，直接就刷新在你身边了，然后跟你说了两句话，扔下了一个道具，就是那个银行卡嘛，然后就离开了，走就再没出现过。而且你说你哥爱你，你哥挺你帮你，我相信，但是你在六个月内给一个主播花了20万美金，你哥的反应竟然是把他的银行卡接着再给你了，意思是你接着花哥买单是吧？你哥就是对你再好，好，他知道你没钱了，他当场给你转点钱，转1000块钱，我信，但他直接把银行卡给你了，我咋就那么不信呢？然后你看他说吧，他住了一晚酒店，第二天还有一个面试去了，对吧？然后第三天的这个早上，警察上门逮捕，整个的这个过程超过48个小时了吧？没有家里任何一个人跟他联系过，打过电话，见过面。然后呢，他自己这还总结说啊，这是我最后一次的见到我家里这三个人了。这话听得我都就起鸡皮疙瘩。如果你知道你家里人，你到底是什么情况？你如果知道你家里人都死了，你就这反应；如果你不知道你家里人都死了，这你总结的还挺好啊。而且警察也很奇怪，也挺深沉的，并没有进一步去深究这个问题，反而去转头去问时间线上的事情了。这个警察的审讯意图特别的明显，一直都在构建时间线。
You had Cody's card tonight?
Right.
Let me say, do you still have your dad's card?
Yes.
Okay, so I had that. Okay, do you use any of them?
I had used Cody's card to pay for one of my bills that was outstanding. It was just one of those from that site. It was just like a bill that had backed up.
How much was that?
There. $5.99.
Okay. Cody know you were doing that?
Yeah.
He said it's okay to do that?
He said to use this to like, survive until things can get figured out.
这个家伙啊，杀了家里的三个人之后，第一件事情竟然是先拿他哥的卡，赶紧先给网红啊，先给女神接着花钱。
We've come and talked to you. You rode up here voluntarily with us to talk to us. Why do you think we're having this conversation?
I honestly don't know, but I'm pretty freaked out at this point because, you know, it's I mean, I know, like, how the situation was when I left, and, you know, I thought that it was weird to begin with that I hadn't gotten any communication whatsoever. I mean, like I had told you, my brother, Cody, the last time when I was away from the house, that he was the one who outreached to me via email, because, again, I didn't have my phone or anything like that. So...I mean, I thought that it was weird, but I had just been kind of putting it out of my mind, thinking, okay, you had to go to work, or they're busy, or something.
When you were in your room, the hotel room,
hotel.
Hanging out, watching TV?
No, I didn't turn on the TV. I had on just, like, music in the background, just kind of helped me go to sleep.
Are you sure about that? Because the hotel, it's weird, and I didn't know this. I used to travel a lot for work. They can tell, because of the TV, every channel you've been on, when the TV gets turned off, I guess they have a problem. Yeah, I guess they have a problem with people stealing from that.
Oh, wow.
So those things are well monitored, even though it looks like a cheap...
Yeah. I never even touched the TV remote. I didn't turn on that TV at all. I was just using my service to like, watch YouTube initially, and then... And then
you're using the Surface to check things.
Right.
So
yeah.
There'll be a history of everywhere you went on it.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. As a child, we're told the truth always is the best thing to do. Correct.
Correct.
You agree with me?
Yeah.
And accidents happen, and things in the heat of the moment, things happen that we wish hadn't happened. But I do it myself sometimes. My kids will make me so aggravated, I'll snap at them and then walk away and say, wow, I wish I would not have done that. That was not very adult of me to snap at my child for something. Yes, they're wrong, but I should be the adult and not snap at them.
Right.
Tell me what...
好糟糕的话说，格兰特是个什么人？30岁了还跟父母住在一起，整天打游戏，大学没毕业，工作被开除，过去的6个月花了20万，在一个从来没见过面的一个网红身上，最终还把他全家人家里3口人都杀了。这是一个完全没有长大，严重依赖父母，又严重厌恶自己父母管着自己的一个小孩啊！你跟他提，我们小时候都被告知要诚实，你拿他当小孩看，你这不是往枪口上撞吗？这么说会立即引发他心理上的这种抵抗情绪的。而且这个警察还跟他说啊，我跟我的孩子什么怎么怎么样。格兰特又没结婚没孩子，你跟他说这个他完全没有共鸣啊。就算有共鸣也是跟你孩子有共鸣，他不是跟你有共鸣，你一下变成敌人了。这是一个严重的战术失误。还有前面也是，为什么要说话呢？不说了，你在警察，你上网，你看电视，你看了什么，你上网查了什么，都有记录。你都把话顶到这一步了，这叫 logical argument， 叫逻辑辩论。而警察肯定是基于证据的逻辑辩论，他肯定是有证据的。你已经逻辑上抓到这个问题了，你有证据，你就保持沉默看着他，你让他自己去解释自己就好了。你看他怎么为自己辩解吗？警察莫名其妙的插话，把人家当儿子训。接着看吧。
What you think? Because I can tell by I've done this for a long, long time, and I read people the way they act, and the way they talk to me, and the way they answer questions.There's something you want to tell us. I can see it in your eyes. I can see it in your body language and just the way you act. Now's the time. Now's the time. If there's something you want to get off your chest and give us an explanation of what's bothering you, now is the exact time to do it. And I'm giving you that opportunity. Something really bothered this guy. It's not that, you know, I spent a bunch of money I shouldn't have on this girl. So be it. You did. It's over with. Money can be made back. Something's bothering you.
I'm just worried about what is all transpiring from this.
I think at this point right now, to be honest with you, Grant, you know what it is. It's in your eyes. Your eyes is the view to your soul, and it's in your eyes. And it sounds stupid, and people don't believe it. Like I told you out there in the car, did I not tell you?You may not like what I say, but I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you the truth every time because I can walk in front of anybody in God and say, I don't care. I told him the truth.
And we usually know answers before we ask it.
Right.
这个男警看到是真着急啊，说的全是套话。你看前面有扫射啊，提了一下上帝，看看对方有没有反应。我以为是他们这个部门的前期工作做得一塌糊涂，做得很差的。结果你看这个女警一语中的，我们警察在问你问题的时候，我们通常都是知道答案的。哇，你看看人家这个水平。所以不是他们这个部门的问题，是这个男警他自己的问题。
Me and Eva knew everything before we asked you the questions. Now's the time to come to Jesus, be honest, because you're holding something back. I can see it in your eyes. People don't believe that the police will help you, but we are actually here to help you with issues you may have. I think something happened, and you don't want to tell us.But right now is the time to get it off your chest. And I really wish you would because it will make you feel better in the end.
I genuinely don't have anything else that I can say about the night or, you know, the period of time afterwards.
There's only one opportunity to make that good impression. And to, if we've done something we shouldn't have done,You fess up there. You caught your hand in a cookie jar. You do it. Now,
is there anything else that happened at the house that you didn't tell us that you've left out or we haven't asked you that would be of importance? Or during the time that you drove around for those few hours, did you ever really go back to the house that you haven't told us about?
This 女警的水平比这个男警真的是高10倍。
Something that happened that caused you to defend yourself.
No, because again, it's like I didn't have any means to defend myself. I mean, I didn't.
I know you've searched for something. I know something. I can't tell you exactly, but you said you, won't you tell me, and I'll tell you if you're being tricky. What'd you search?
On, when I had gone to the Panera, I searched for, like, top stories, Oviedo or Chuliota or something like that.
And found what?
And then I saw that there was, it was, like, just the initial, like, it had, like, a video, but I didn't listen to the video, but it had just an initial thing of that there was shootings in Salt and Circle. But it didn't say, like, the address or who was involved. It was just, like, this is the preliminary.
Was that on one of the news stations?
What was
the site you searched?
I honestly can't remember.
I think
it was one of the Weshes.
Saw the story, because we've seen the same stories. You've seen the story. Because there's a thing that will tell me how long of the time you spent on that.
Right.
You saw what happened.
Yeah, I was on there for like 20 seconds.
Well, what was your thoughts when you reviewed that story?
I was freaking out, and I was just like blank. I didn't know what to do.
Now's the time. Now is the time.
So what do you think happened?
To be honest.
Now is time for what? 我真的想把这个男警赶出去。你再看看女警啊。步步紧逼，杀人案新闻都出来了，你也看了，你自己搜的，对吧？这非常可疑的行为，那么你也承认你看了，那你觉得发生什么事情？这是谁假谁死了？
What happened at the house?
Tell me what happened.
I don't know what happened.
I know better. Listen to me. I know better. I can help you, Grant, with honesty. I can help you with honesty.
We think something else happened before you left the home.That you're either afraid of or embarrassed to talk about. But we need to know exactly what happened because, like Danny said, we can place you there at certain times. And so we need to know what happened before you left that house because you didn't leave with everything being okay.
I honestly don't have anything else that I can really say. I mean, I don't know.
Do you even know why law enforcement got involved?Like, what brought us to that home?
No, I...
You just said it. You know something bad happened there. Out of your voice, not mine. I have not told you anything what's happened there. Something bad happened. You're here with us for a couple hours. You admit that you've looked at a site and seen something bad happen. Because the video is not of just a general area. It's of a specific location, correct?
Yeah, I saw like a driveway or something.
Whose driveway did you say?
I don't know. I saw like there was like a gate. There was a gate, and then I saw like that there was like two cars. But then I didn't see anything past that.
Okay.
Well, is that driveway and gate your home?
I honestly did not fixate on it for like a long period of time. I saw like the one with an actual like gate.
Did anything more happen with you and your father besides him grabbing you up from the couch and yelling at you and kicking you out? Anything at all? Did he harm you, hit you?
No.
Draw any weapons on you?
No. He didn't do anything like that. I mean, he was just yelling.
This is the time to come to Jesus, to be honest.Because you know more. I'm looking in your eyes tell me exactly that you are hurting inside. I get it. Brother, I get it. You're hurting.
And this is
the only
time we can help you.
Because once we get to a certain point, there's nothing I can do. It's in the hands of who has it. Nothing I can do. Honesty is always the best policy. You get caught stealing a car, you admit to it, I did it. How can I get help? What can be done to help me?And let me tell you the rest of my story. You're holding back.
And if something happened that you were defending yourself, then we need to know that. If you were protecting yourself because you were in fear, then that makes sense. But we need to know exactly what happened for you to protect yourself.
You can't minimize this. Once, a wise man told me one time, once a bomb goes off, you can't defuse it. You can't. That's already out there.Now is the point to say, how do I put Band-Aids on myself to minimize the injuries I have? And we're giving you that opportunity. I want to give you that opportunity. I don't think you're a bad guy at all. I really don't. I think you're going through a very stressful and emotional time right now with being out of work and just dealing with all the problems with the arrest. You're probably not used to depending on somebody to pay all your bills. So now you have to do mom and dad or have to give you money. Cody's having to give you money. And there's a significant debt to people. $200,000, I don't know what I'd do. I mean, mortgage, yeah, I get it, or something like that, or a medical bill for my child, yeah, I get it. But talking to some girl, you know, in Bulgaria, you know, you hit it right on the head, you were embarrassed about it. And you have nothing to be embarrassed about.
And you said you had a connection with her.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And...
我的妈呀，这个男警是我有史以来见过最糟糕的警察了。这怎么开始嘲讽起格兰特了？你看他说那个话，你个傻屌，你又不是买房贷款，你又不是给小孩看病，你给远在地球另外一端那个保加利亚的女孩，你从来都没见过，你根本都不认识那个女人，你花了$20,000。你看还多亏人家那个女警，这反应是真快啊，赶紧说啊，你说你们是有真爱的，一下把这个事给圆回来了，他不是傻，他是真爱，是真的有感情。
Glad you haven't heard from anybody.
Yeah, I mean, it's like it's words that like I can't think of to even say. Like I don't know how to even say the words.
Well, give me a roundabout what you're thinking.
That somebody in my family's dead.
What?终于啊，终于这是走出第一步了，我看的都快要急死了，我要休息一会儿了，我真的头都大了。大家是喜欢这个视频的话，记得点赞、留言、转发。后续呢，我会尽快更新，请一定关注我的频道。好，我是艾克长万年，我们下期再见了，拜拜。